Hello students, in last class we have studied about the process of spermatogenesis, that is nothing but the process of formation of sperms. Today I am going to explain about the hormonal regulation of spermatogenesis or the hormonal control of spermatogenesis. See, the process of gametogenesis is mainly regulated or controlled by some of the hormones which are secreted in the body. Okay, so where you have studied the detailed process of spermatogenesis, where the germinal epithelial cells found in the seminiferous tubules, they divide mitotically and produce spermatogonia or the sperm mother cell. So they divides and further they produce primary spermatocytes, and the primary spermatocyte they undergo meiosis and produce secondary spermatocytes. Ultimately they produce spermatids, where by the process what is called as spermiation or the spermatoleosis, the spermatids get converted into active sperms or the matured sperms. See, this process is mainly under the control of certain hormones, as well as even the oogenesis also, it is also under the control of certain hormones. So mainly the gametogenesis is regulated by the hormones which are secreted, some of the hormones which are secreted in the body. So that is the topic for today's session. So that is hormonal regulation of spermatogenesis. Okay. See, all of you have well known about the hypothalamus, that is considered as master of master glands. It means it is a master above all the other endocrine glands which is found, including the pituitary which is found in the body. That's why it is considered as master of master glands. This will secrete a hormone, that is what is called as GnRH, that is gonadotropin releasing hormone. The hypothalamus can observe this schematic representation where it secretes gonadotropin releasing hormone GnRH, that in turn stimulates the anterior pituitary gland. You know that there are two lobes in pituitary gland, one is adenohypophysis, another one is neurohypophysis. So among that, the anterior pituitary gland that secretes gonadotropins, they were mainly FSH and LH. Gonadotropin releasing hormone released by the hypothalamus that stimulates anterior pituitary gland, that will release us gonadotropins. Gonadotropins are mainly FSH and LH. FSH means follicular stimulating hormone. You have studied the endocrine glands in your previous class, that is follicular stimulating hormone. Stimulating hormone, that is FSH. Similarly, LH. LH means luteinizing hormone. LH means luteinizing hormone. So both together what is called as gonadotropins. See, the follicular stimulating hormone that in turn stimulates the Sertoli cells which are found in the seminiferous tubule, and these Sertoli cells in turn influences the sperm production, that is the formation of sperms. It means in turn it stimulates the germinal epithelial cells of the seminiferous tubules to undergo division and to produce a sperm. It means they induce spermatogenesis, that is the formation of the sperm. On the other hand, the LH, that is luteinizing hormone, this in turn stimulates the interstitial cells or Leydig cells which are found in the testicles. They secretes testosterone. It means a major androgen that is found in males. Luteinizing hormone stimulates interstitial cells of the testis or the Leydig cells of the testis. In turn, the Leydig cells under the stimulus of LH, that is luteinizing hormone, under its stimulus, they secrete testosterone. Testosterone are the androgens, they are very much necessary for the secretion of the sperm, for the production of the sperms. So in turn, the testosterone also, it triggers or stimulates the Sertoli cells. So where that helps in the processing of the sperm, it means the maturation and the development, further development of the sperm, where it in turn it stimulates, also stimulates Sertoli cells. And the major hormone, this is responsible for all kinds of secondary sexual characters in males. So when the level of FSH increases in the blood, the Sertoli cell, it will produce a glycoprotein, a hormone, that is what is called as inhibin. The Sertoli cells, they secrete a glycoprotein hormone called as inhibin. In turn, the inhibin that stimulates or sends a message for hypothalamus to stop the synthesis of this GnRH, that is gonadotropin releasing hormone. In turn, the pituitary gland is not stimulated, hence the synthesis of FSH will be stopped. Similarly, when the level of testosterone is increased, this was recognized are the testosterone that sends a negative feedback. When the level of testosterone rises in the blood or increases, this sends a negative feedback. So where again it stops the synthesis of GnRH, and in turn the pituitary gland, the anterior pituitary gland, will stop the release of luteinizing hormone. See, the hypothalamus that secretes gonadotropin releasing hormone, this gonadotropin releasing hormone that in turn stimulates or sends a message for anterior pituitary gland or adenohypophysis. This adenohypophysis that secretes the two hormones, that is gonadotropins, like follicular stimulating hormone and the luteinizing hormone. The follicular stimulating hormone that stimulates, it moves in the bloodstream, that stimulates the Sertoli cells. In turn, the Sertoli cells that influences the sperm production, it means they influences the germinal epithelial cells to divide and produce the sperms. And also there is a major role of luteinizing hormone on the interstitial cells or the Leydig cells. So where under the stimulus of LH, the Leydig cells produce another hormone, what is called as testosterone and androgen. So this also having an effect on spermatogenesis, it means in turn it stimulates the Sertoli cells also. So when the level of testosterone is high or a maximum extent or amount, the spermatogenesis will be at its maximum extent. Okay, andre maximum agi sperms formation agutte, testosterone levels jaasti idre. Testosterone level kammi idaga, so it may in turn leads to sterility in males. Okay, so adike treatment ide, testosterone therapy antane kodtare. So when the level increases, the level of testosterone increases, it sends a negative feedback. It means it sends a message, a signal, or the hypothalamus that recognizes increase in the level of testosterone. So then it stops with the synthesis of, or lowers the synthesis of GnRH, that is gonadotropin releasing hormone. In turn, the anterior pituitary gland is not stimulated. Hence, the level of LH will decrease. Similarly, when the level of FSH increases, the Sertoli cells, they secrete a glycoprotein called as inhibin. So this in turn sends a signal or a message for hypothalamus. So again, it stimulates the anterior pituitary gland when the level of FSH will be stopped. Okay, so this is about the hormonal regulation of spermatogenesis. And the next concept is about the structure of human sperm or the ultrastructure of the sperm. See, sperm is a specialized sex cell, or is nothing but a gamete, the male gamete, which is produced inside the testicles, as you know. And the sperm is about a shape of a tadpole or a dart-like structure that nearly measures about 55 to 60 micrometers in the length. It is a tadpole-like structure or a dart-like structure that nearly measures about 55 to 60 micrometers in its length, and about 3.5 to 5 micrometers in its diameter. And mainly the sperm is divisible into three portions. The major three regions can be observed in the sperm. One is the head, another one is the middle piece, another one is the tail. There are three major portions were observed in the tail, in the sperm. One is the head, another one is the middle piece, another one is the tail. Okay. See, the head of the sperm, it is a pear-shaped structure that mainly encloses the male nucleus or the nucleus which consists of paternal chromosomes. And the head is covered by or consists of a structure what we call as acrosome. The head covered by or the anterior region of the head consists of a structure, and this structure what is called as acrosome. This is the structure mainly responsible for penetration of sperm into egg, where hyaluronidase, acrosin and neuraminidase. See, there are three proteolytic enzymes which are secreted by the acrosome. And these enzymes were mainly hyaluronidase, acrosin and neuraminidase. They are responsible for digesting the wall of the ovum. It means they helps in penetration of the sperm into ovum. The ovum is surrounded by the walls like corona radiata and zona pellucida. So where the sperm penetration is mainly possible with these proteolytic enzymes like hyaluronidase, acrosin and neuraminidase, which is secreted by acrosome. The main function of acrosome helps in penetration of sperm into ovum, and it is derived from the Golgi bodies of the spermatids. Okay. And the next structure which is found in the head, that is the nucleus. The nucleus that encloses haploid set of chromosomes, that is about 23 paternal chromosomes are found in the nucleus of the sperm. And the next region between the head and the middle piece, a small constriction is present. And this small constriction is what is called as a neck. And the neck encloses a centriole called as proximal centriole. And the next one is distal centriole. Proximal centriole is found in the concavity of the nucleus of the sperm, or it is found in the concavity of the head. Whereas distal centriole, you can observe in the diagram here, the distal centriole that continues as axoneme, or it produces the tail part of the sperm. Okay, there are two centrioles were observed here. You know what are centrioles, which are the main structures which helps in separation of the chromosomes, which are mainly found in the animal cells, centrioles and the asters. So they are nothing but, they are formed from the microtubules, the two microtubules which are arranged together forming the centrioles. So there are two centrioles were found in the sperm. One is the proximal centriole, another one is the distal centriole. The proximal centriole that lies in the concavity, you can observe here, in the concavity of the head of the sperm, whereas distal centriole that continues as axial filament and that forms the tail of the sperm. So the next is a very small constriction that lies between the head and the middle piece. Okay, and the next structure is the middle piece. The middle piece that mainly encloses the central distal centriole that continues as axial filament or axoneme. And it consists of spirally arranged about 10 to 14 spirals of mitochondria. The mitochondria which are spirally arranged in the middle piece, they mainly provide energy for the motility of the sperm. And the next thing is about the tail. See, the tail is a major portion of the sperm. Okay, that nearly measures about 50 micrometers in the length. This is a major portion where the tail is divisible into the main piece and the end piece. The main piece from here. From here the tail begins after the end of the middle piece. From here up to here, the entire thing is tail. This is the locomotory organ of the sperm. So where it divisible into main piece and the end piece. See, the main piece of the tail that is covered by a plasma membrane. The main piece is covered by a plasma membrane and it encloses a little amount of cytoplasm. Whereas the end piece, this is a terminal portion of this sperm or the tail. This terminal portion is not covered by plasma membrane and also it doesn't consist of cytoplasm. The tail is a major portion divisible into main piece and the end piece. The main piece of the tail that enclosed by the plasma membrane and it encloses the cytoplasm, whereas the end piece, this is a terminal portion not covered by the plasma membrane and also it doesn't consist of the cytoplasm. By the vibratile movement of the tail, the sperm can move within the genital tract or the genital cavity of the female. Okay, and this is about the structure of the sperm. The sperm that mainly consists of three regions: the head, middle piece and the tail. The head portion of the sperm that encloses the nucleus, a flattened large nucleus is found in the head, and anterior to the nucleus of the sperm, where it consists of a structure called as acrosome, a cap-like structure, that is the acrosome that mainly secretes the enzymes like hyaluronidase, acrosin and neuraminidase. They are responsible for degradation of wall of ovum during fertilization. And this is derived from the Golgi bodies of the spermatids. And a flattened nucleus is found in the head of the sperm, where it consists of paternal set of chromosomes, haploid chromosomes. There are about 23 in number. And a small constriction between the head and the middle piece is what is called as a neck. It encloses the centrioles like proximal centriole and the distal centriole. Proximal centriole that lies in the concavity of the head, whereas the distal centriole that begins from the middle piece and continues up to the end, and where it forms the tail of the sperm. So where the middle piece that is covered by or enveloped by the plasma membrane or a flexible sheath, and it consists of the spirally arranged mitochondria. So where, and next part is the tail. The tail consists of main piece and the end piece. The main piece is covered by the plasma membrane, encloses the cytoplasm, whereas the end piece or the terminal portion is devoid of plasma membrane and it doesn't consist of cytoplasm. The main function of the tail is to move the sperm in the female genital tract. Okay, so this is about the ultrastructure of human sperm, and the major question will be asked in the examination for 5 marks. Explain the structure of human sperm, or draw a neat label diagram of human sperm for about 3 or 5 marks. Okay, and the next concept is about oogenesis. See, the oogenesis is the process of formation of ovum in the ovary. So, or it is a process of formation, development and maturation of ova or the egg from the diploid ovum mother cells or oogonia of the ovary is called as oogenesis. See, the process of oogenesis, the early stages, they were begins in the fetal stage itself. When the female fetus is about 25 weeks old in the mother's womb, the oogenesis that starts. There are many number of follicles which are produced in that stage, but only few of them will reach maturity during the reproductive age of the female. So where some divisions which occurs in the fetal stage itself produces the many number of follicles. No further follicles will added after the birth. Okay, they were produced in the fetal stage itself. See, the oogenesis process is mainly divided into 3 phases, like multiplication phase, growth phase and the maturation phase. During the multiplication phase, the germinal epithelial cell of the ovary, I have explained in the last class while explaining the structure of the ovary, where ovary is lined by germinal epithelium. The germinal epithelial cells of the ovary, they divide repeatedly by means of mitotic divisions and produces the many number of follicles. That is in the fetal state of about 25 weeks old. Okay. So where it produces many number of rounded masses. They were what we called as egg nests. There are many number of round masses were produced. They were called as egg nests. In turn which produces the follicles. And where the follicles which are produced by the division of germinal epithelial cells, that is what is called as multiplication phase, where the germinal epithelial cell that divides and produces many number of diploid structures, that is what is called as oogonia or the ovum mother cell, where it produces the structures, the rounded masses called as the egg nest, and this will in turn that produces the follicles. So where the follicles were what is called as oogonia. Okay, that is nothing but the ovum mother cells. See, their number is increased or produced in the fetal stage. No follicles were added after the birth. In the next phase, that is the growth phase. See, this will begins only after attaining the puberty. Means once the female attains puberty, the process of oogenesis that continues. The early stages were started in the fetal stage itself. Until that, the further process is arrested. Then the growth phase that begins once the females attain puberty. So where this phase is very slow and a prolonged phase, where the follicles, some of the follicles or one of the follicle that absorb nutrition from the surrounding follicular cells and enlarges in size, and now this is what we call as primary oocyte. The growth phase that begins after the puberty, during the growth phase, one of the follicle that absorb nutrition from the surrounding follicular cell, I have said many number of follicles are produced by the egg nest. Among that, few of them will reach as a maturity. So where, when the puberty begins, one of the follicles that absorbs nutrition from the surrounding follicular cells, mainly the follicles will also supply nutrition for the development of the mature follicle. So then it enlarges in the size. That is what is called as primary oocyte. See, this primary oocyte that enters into the maturation phase. See, during maturation phase, the primary oocyte undergoes reductional cell division. That is what is called as meiosis. So, where meiosis 1 that occurs in the primary oocyte, that results in the formation of two haploid structures. Among that, one will be the larger cell encloses a very prominent nucleus with a large amount of cytoplasm, that is what is called as secondary oocyte, and the another one is what is called as polar body, the first polar body, this with a very small amount of cytoplasm, unequal in size, where secondary oocyte is larger when compared to this one, with encloses a very small amount of cytoplasm, and that is what is called as first polar body. The primary oocyte undergoes meiosis 1. You know that meiosis is a reductional cell division, that too meiosis 1 is actual reductional cell division, where it results in the formation of two daughter cells. Unequal cytokinesis occurs, that results in the formation of two unequal cells. One is a larger secondary oocyte and another one is a smaller, the first polar body. See, in humans and in some vertebrates, the polar body, they do not divide further, simply degenerates. Okay. And this secondary oocyte, this is the haploid structure with 23 chromosomes, that is maternal chromosomes, which are enclosed in the secondary oocyte. The secondary oocyte, then it enters into meiosis 2. It enters into meiosis 2, where the division of this one, the secondary oocyte, will be arrested in metaphase 2. The division, the further divisions will be arrested in metaphase 2. It means the ovum is released in the form of secondary oocyte. Competitive examination alli kelidare sumasala neatly. At which stage the ovum is released from the graphene follicle, that is at secondary oocyte stage. Once after the division of primary oocyte, it produces secondary oocyte. You know meiosis is having two phases, meiosis 1 and meiosis 2. Whereas meiosis 2, the secondary oocyte that enters into meiosis 2, so where its division is arrested or stopped, or the secondary oocyte that rests at metaphase 2. The further division of the secondary oocyte that takes place in the fallopian tube, that is during fertilization. Only after the entry of sperm into secondary oocyte, and now that is what is called as ovum, because the ovum is released in the form of secondary oocyte, where the division is stopped at metaphase 2. The further divisions will begin in the fallopian tube. Okay. So during fertilization, the further divisions of the secondary oocyte that will be completed, because the sperm will release a certain factors which are responsible for the completion of the division of the secondary oocyte. Okay. So where it degenerates the factor called as metaphase promoting factor, MPF. The sperm entry degenerates the factors called as metaphase promoting factor, MPF, metaphase promoting factor, and it induces the activation of APF. APF means anaphase promoting factor. The entry of sperm that induces certain changes in the secondary oocyte, the main changes includes the degeneration of metaphase promoting factor and the activation of anaphase promoting factor that induces the secondary oocyte to complete its second meiotic division. It means after the metaphase, it enters into anaphase and finally it completes its further divisions. Okay. But in the secondary oocyte stage, the egg or the ovum is released. During that, once it completes its meiosis 2, it releases another polar body into the perivitelline space. It means it is a space between the plasma membrane of the egg and another layer, what is called as zona pellucida. I will explain in next class. Okay. So, while explaining the structure of the egg or the ovum, the space between the zona pellucida and the plasma membrane of the egg is called as perivitelline space. So, once the secondary oocyte, it completes its division during fertilization, it releases another structure, what is called as the second polar body. Okay. So, but the secondary oocyte is released as such. It means the ovulation takes place at secondary oocyte stage. The graphene follicle that ruptures and releases the ovum at secondary oocyte stage. So, the main hormone responsible for releasing the ovum is LH, that is luteinizing hormone. Its further divisions will be induced only after the entry of the sperm. Ok. Okay, so that is during the fertilization. I said the sperm entry that degenerates the factor called as MPF, that is metaphase promoting factor, and activates the factors called as APF, that is anaphase promoting factor, where further divisions will occur in the secondary oocyte. Okay, that is during fertilization. Okay, see, the process of oogenesis mainly consists of phase of multiplication, phase of growth, and phase of maturation. I have said that the many number of follicles, nearly 1 million follicles, which are produced in the fetal stage itself, when fetus is about 25 weeks old, further follicles which do not add further, then few of them will reach us maturity, about 400 to 450 follicles will reach maturity, it means 400 to 450 ovum will be produced during the reproductive period of the female. So this phase will be completed in the fetal stage itself. Until then, there will be a long gap phase is observed. So where the growth phase. So this begins once the female attains puberty, where some of the follicles will start absorbing a nutrition from the surrounding follicular cells that enlarges in size, and that is what is called as primary oocyte. Primary oocyte is diploid, encloses about 46 chromosomes, whereas oogonia, the ovum mother cell, also encloses about 46 chromosomes. So where this primary oocyte will promptly enters into the maturation phase, where during the maturation phase, the primary oocyte undergoes meiosis. The meiosis 1, that is a reductional cell division, results in the formation of two haploid cells. So the unequal division of the cytoplasm of the primary oocyte because of meiosis 1 results in the formation of a secondary oocyte. So where this is the larger one, encloses large amount of cytoplasm, whereas the first polar body is released. See, in mammals, especially in human beings, this polar body do not divide further. Okay. So whereas the secondary oocyte is released as such during ovulation. So where this is what is called as ootid or the ovum. The further divisions, as I said, it occurs in the fallopian tube during fertilization. Okay. See, during this maturation phase, there are certain changes which occurs, like increase in the volume of the cytoplasm, increase in the reserve food content, okay, increase in the number of mitochondria, complexity of the endoplasmic reticulum of this one will increases. It means it completely becomes a matured ovum. All physiological changes and the cytological changes that takes place in this one, so where the ovum is released. Okay, see, the human egg is alacetyl. It consists of very less yolk, or even the yolk or the reserve food material. We have seen in other animals, groups of animals like reptiles and as well as in apes. Okay, so where they enclose a very large amount of yolk. But here the egg is alacetyl, or it is microlacetyl. So where it is evenly distributed, hence it is said to be isolacetyl. And these eggs are not cleidoic. You know what are cleidoic eggs? It means the eggs are surrounded by a calcareous shell. But here, these are not cleidoic eggs. Means there is no shell here. And there is no need of storing yolk also. Because as the further development of the young one, which takes place within the body of the mother, there is a nutritional connection directly between the developing young one and the mother's body. Hence, no need of storing yolk. But it's not the case in other animals, like in birds, where once the birds lays the eggs, the eggs consists of rich amount of yolk, rich amount of reserve food material. So where embryo that develops by utilizing that nutrition, so further development that takes place within that egg only. Okay, but this is not the case in case of higher animals, especially in mammals, where as there is a nutritional connection between the mother and the developing fetus, no need of storing extra reserve food material. Okay, so this is about the process of oogenesis. So in the next class, I explain about the hormonal regulation of oogenesis, how oogenesis is regulated by hormones, just like spermatogenesis, and the structure of the ovum. Okay, thank you.